Hello, and welcome to JAMA Evidence, our podcast series based on core issues in evidence-based medicine. Today, we'll be discussing conditional power. I'm your host, Dr. Roger Lewis, Senior Statistical Editor for JAMA and co-editor of the JAMA Guide to Statistics and Methods series. I'm here with Ben Saville. So, Dr. Saville, thank you for joining us today. Can you go ahead and tell our listeners a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Thank you, Roger. I am President and Lead Statistical Scientist at Adaptix Trials. I'm also an Adjunct Associate Professor of Biostatistics at Vanderbilt University School of Medicine. And I specialize in Bayesian and adaptive clinical trial design, really striving to find innovative solutions to really challenging problems that we encounter in trial design.
Well, thank you very much for joining us today. One of the challenges that faces all of us who work in clinical trials is knowing as a trial is progressing, whether we should continue the effort or whether we should stop the effort for various reasons. And one of the key tools in that is conditional power, which you've written about in your article. So let's start with the concept of power as it's traditionally used in the design of a clinical trial. What is power?
Yeah, so statistical power is the idea, the concept that you want to know the probability that you're going to have a successful result for your trial, a successful conclusion, meaning we've demonstrated superiority, for example, of a therapy, under a given set of assumptions about what the underlying treatment effect is. So you make an assumption that says, I think we're 10% better on this intervention versus control. Under that assumption, I can figure out through statistical power calculations what sample size would give me an 80% probability of achieving a successful conclusion about superiority.
So if you use that approach to determine the appropriate sample size during the design of a trial, what's different once patients are enrolled and we start to have some data from the trial?
Once you start the trial, that initial assumption you made about the treatment effect that you think exists, it kind of becomes irrelevant because really you're running the trial, you're going to some predetermined sample size, and you could be wrong, you could be right. But as the trial goes on, you're going to learn how close your assumptions that you originally had when you designed the trial, how closely they align with the observed data. And the idea of conditional power is to use the accruing data that are coming in through the trial. And you're going to use it for two things. Number one, you're going to condition on the current observed data that you may have at a certain time point, as well as learn information about the treatment effect that gives you some better guesses as to what that true treatment effect may be. So really two parts of conditional power is one, we would like to update this probability of success based on the observed data that we have to date. And number two, using that observed data to understand what the likely benefit is on future patients we haven't yet enrolled.
So I know sometimes when thinking about conditional power, people like to use sports analogies. Can you use that to explain what conditional power is?
Absolutely. At any given point in a clinical trial, you're going to have some measure, some estimate about what the current benefit is that you're seeing with the observed data. And it's much like a basketball game where you know the score. You can look and say, hey, team A is winning by so many points over team B. And then the other piece of that says, well, how much time is left in the game? I mean, if team A is up by 10 points, is it the end of the fourth quarter or is it halftime? If it's halftime, there's a lot of time for the other team to catch up. If it's near the end of the game, the conclusion is nearly certain. And so clinical trials is very similar in some respects. There's a measure of what the treatment benefit is at any given time, and then how much information is yet to be collected, how much time is left in the game. And that's going to drive the probability of getting a successful result in this trial or not. So based not only just on the current data, but also how much information is yet to be collected in this trial.
So why is it that we care about conditional power?
Well, I think we care about conditional power because when we run a trial, we should be frequently assessing whether that trial should continue. We want to know, okay, do the data align with our initial expectations in this trial where we have a chance of actually having a successful result? If the probability of a successful result is very low, then we want to stop the trial to protect the patients, protect time, resources. But if there's a reasonable chance of having a successful result, you'd want the trial to keep going.
So how does one use the data that you have to actually calculate conditional power?
The data that you have feed into the conditional power calculation in two ways. Number one, you're going to assume that the data you've observed up to that time point are fixed and they're not going to change. So we have some data up to a certain time point, that data is fixed. Now we have additional data that's yet to come in, and we have to make some assumptions about what treatment effect exists in the future data. And we can do that either by learning from the previous data. So we know what the current treatment effect is, for example, and it allows us to make some statements about the likelihood of different treatment effects that may exist for the future patients. Or we could ignore that interim data and go back to what we originally assumed at the beginning of the trial. There's various things we could assume for the future patients. And really, conditional power is the idea that you're going to condition on some assumption. And it's called conditional power regardless of how you use the data to make that assumption.
Okay, so we have the data in hand that we assume is not going to change. And then we have to make some assumption about the treatment effect in the future patients. Let's now talk about the example that you cite in your article regarding the use of conditional power. Talk a little bit about what those investigators did and what they found.
Yeah, so in this trial, they had a predetermined sample size of 1,120 patients based on a power calculation they did before the study began. They then started collecting data. They ran the trial. They did an interim analysis of around 412 patients. And at the interim analysis, they asked the question, given these 412 patients, what's the probability that we're going to have a successful result when we get up to 1120? So given the current data we have right now with 412 and some assumptions about the future data, here's the probability of having a successful trial. They calculated that probability and they conditioned again on those 412. They weren't quite sure which treatment effect to assume for the future patients. So they did it a few different ways. Their initial calculation was actually based on their original assumption, which was a 9% benefit on the 90-day mortality. And that conditional power calculation gave them a probability of 44%. And they viewed that as optimistic because they know there is uncertainty in what assumption they use for the future patients. They also ran additional calculations for smaller treatment effects, ranging between 2 and 10%, I believe. And what they did was they showed the conditional power range between 5% and 44%, or maybe it was 48%. But the idea being that the probability of that trial being successful was small, except under the most optimistic assumptions. And those most optimistic assumptions, they still only had a 44% chance of having a successful result.
So they were faced with a challenge in figuring out what to assume about the future patients. And one thing that struck me about your example was the inconsistency between the data they had at the interim analysis and their originally assumed treatment benefit. So what did they actually have in those approximately 400 patients, and how did that compare to their original assumptions?
So in those 400 patients, the interim data, they were actually 2% in the wrong direction. So they actually had an increase in the 90-day mortality. Their original assumption was a 9 percentage point benefit or decrease in the mortality rate. So their observed rate was very different than what they initially assumed. And because of that, they recognized, rightly so in the article, this was a very optimistic conditional power calculation. And because of that, they provided additional conditional power calculations with other less optimistic assumptions about what that treatment effect may be.
So they were obviously faced with the challenge that there was uncertainty in the true benefit or degree of harm in the future patients. And you talk in your article about an approach that actually averages over that uncertainty. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. So conceptually, what they did was they said, well, we don't really know what that effect is. So let's give conditional power for a 2% benefit, a 4% benefit, a 6% benefit, and an 8% benefit. And they just gave different power calculations. An alternative strategy to this idea of giving multiple calculations of conditional power is using a single probability that recognizes what the likelihood of each of those effect sizes may be. And this is called Bayesian predictive power. And the Bayesian predictive power essentially is a weighted average across those different assumptions, where those assumptions are weighted by the likelihood of that assumption being true. So, for example, an assumption of a 9% benefit doesn't have a very high likelihood given the current observed data of a 2% increase in mortality. But a smaller treatment effect, such as a 2% benefit, that would have a higher likelihood because it's more consistent with the observed data. A Bayesian predictive probability is going to, this idea is you get a single probability for the probability of a successful result that does the same thing as conditional power in that it conditions on the observed data as fixed and not changing. But the future data that is based on a weighted average of plausible values of the treatment effect. And you get a single probability for the probability of success using the Bayesian paradigm of predictive power.
One of the challenges in calculating conditional power is what assumptions to make about the treatment effect in future patients. What are the different approaches that can be taken?
There are really three different approaches that you typically see in that assumption required for conditional power. The first one is to use the original assumption that you used when you started the trial, before you collected any data. And that's what the authors of this paper have done, where they had that original assumption of a 9% benefit. But it essentially ignores the interim data in terms of how consistent the data are with that assumption. The second approach says, well, hey, we have data, let's use that. So we're going to use a point estimate for the current treatment effect, and we're going to assume that all patients in the future have that treatment benefit. And so the idea there is you use a point estimate of the interim data to inform what that assumption is for the future patients. But that ignores the uncertainty. The third approach is, well, let's use the data, but let's also incorporate the uncertainty. And yes, we have an estimate, but we know there's uncertainty there. So let's use a weighted estimate where we also allow for different possible values of that future treatment effect, weighted by some distribution that's based on those observed data.
So in the trial that you use an example in your article, what did they actually do?
In this trial, they used conditional power as an interim analysis to calculate a 44% probability of success given the observed data and a very optimistic assumption about the treatment effect for future patients. And they concluded that, well, it's a very low chance, even under very optimistic settings. So what happened was the data monitoring committee, they made the recommendation to stop the trial. So they stopped the trial on the grounds of futility, saying that, well, number one, it's difficult to enroll in this population, so feasibility enrollment. But number two, it's a low likelihood of success, even if we keep going up to 1,000 plus patients. And so they made a recommendation to stop that trial.
So after the trial was stopped, how should one interpret the final results? Does one use the conditional power in interpreting the final results?
It's a great question. When you actually have the trial done and you have the data in hand, you don't really care about the conditional power calculation anymore. You made a decision to stop the trial. We have the data in hand. And now we're going to use traditional statistics, trying to estimate the treatment effect and understand the uncertainty in the observed data.
So I know in the example in your article, they didn't actually use the Bayesian predictive power. But if they had, what kind of result would they have achieved?
So we actually did that probability calculation using the Bayesian framework. And if they had done this during the course of the trial, they would have seen the predictive probability of success was only 2%. And so that is based not on a specific assumption about what the future rate may be. That's using the current observed data to get a distribution of what the likely values of that treatment effect may be and averaging across all those to get a probability of success of 2%. So quite low.
In your article, when you discuss the limitations of this approach, you talk specifically about the difficulties in knowing what assumed benefit we use for those future patients whose outcomes we've not yet seen. And it seems as if there are several different approaches that you've discussed, including using the originally assumed treatment effect, using the particular treatment effect that is observed, or averaging over the uncertainty in that future treatment effect. Of these, which do you prefer?
Well, I certainly prefer the Bayesian predictive power approach because it gives you a single number in terms of here's our probability of success using quantitative methodologies to understand what that distribution looks like. I think there's a lot of subjectivity that goes into conditional power because you have to basically give multiple power calculations and think about, you know, subjectively, okay, how likely is this value? How likely is this value? I would rather have a formal mechanism to think about what that probability of success is that averages across the uncertainty based on the observed data, as opposed to me trying to come up with subjective plausibility statements about each one of those treatment effects.
So let's review the key takeaways for our listeners regarding why we use conditional power and the types of assumptions that are made in calculating conditional power.
Well, the first takeaway is that when we run a trial, we should be frequently assessing whether that trial should continue. And the conditional power calculation is very useful for that assessment. In order to make that calculation, this is the second takeaway, is that you need some assumption about the treatment effect for future data that needs to be collected. And the third takeaway is that, well, we can use the data that we have in hand and account for the uncertainty in the estimate to inform that assumption. So now we have an assumption, but accounting for the uncertainty. So that's really the third takeaway, is understanding that we can account for that with Bayesian predictive power some other way than just assuming a single fixed assumption.
I'm Roger Lewis, and I've been speaking with Ben Saville about conditional power. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Masisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.